Here is Dave Courtney and friends in conversation with Freddie Foreman, who was a member of the notorious Kray Twins firm and was known in the London underworld as Brown Bread Fred or the Managing Director of British Crime.
It was when really I went from Battersea. Well, I mean, you couldn't live in a poor area in Sheepcote Lane, Battersea. It's and just down the road there. There was a Latchmere school and the baths, Latchmere baths. I think they're still there today. The Prince's Head and all that area. It was very, very poor. Loads of pubs, mind you. And everyone used to be getting drunk. I mean, my childhood, I can remember every Saturday night, someone's having a big party in someone's house and they're all getting paralytic, you know what I mean? That's all they had to live for. And the other side...
Days, if you weren't a thief, you were poor.
Yeah.
Well, they were dockers. Yeah. It was a different era at the time, you know what I mean?
In Battersea, was a candle factory there?
Yeah, the there was a kind of
work.
Yeah,
there.
I can't,
there
no, I can't think of the name of that. Yeah,
there was.
Could have been. But
you couldn't really lead a normal life.
No, no one had nothing.
The tally
man used to come around if you wanted a new pair of shoes or they knock on the door and you pay sixpence a week.
You
know,
poor. Yeah, for being poor. Was normal life because everyone was poor.
Yeah.
You understand me?
Yeah.
There was no harm in having bread and jam for tea or sugar sandwich because everyone had it. You understand what I mean? It wasn't different being poor. It was normal.
And when you every house in Sheepcote Lane, obviously there was a railway embankment there, and there's a gypsy encampment there, with all caravans on there, you know.
Yeah.
And but everyone got on well, no aggravation at all. Well, I played with all the gypsy kids myself, you know, and they looked after me actually. And down to the end there was a butcher's. Well, where you go and get your peace pudding and faggots and come back with your base, and you know, that was a luxury, wasn't it, in them days?
Yeah.
To, something
peace
like that.
Pudding,
peace pudding
up.
And faggots.
I don't know whether that's still invented, Fred. Peace pudding, I can't remember.
This kid knocked me over on his bike, and I was only little, and these gypsy kids bashed a granny out of him because he knocked me over, and it cut me leg open, and I got all that scar there.
Yeah.
See that scar up there?
Yeah.
And
the original battle scar.
The gypsy kids come and saw it, took me up to the hospital, and the nurses said to me, I'll never forget her words, she said, oh, look at her shape, but that's good. She said, you've got a lucky horseshoe there, she said. You're going to be lucky the rest of your life. And it's weird, though.
And you remembered that when they gave him 10 years. You remembered her saying that.
Have you seen my horseshoe?
To be charged with murder once in your lifetime, twice it happened to me, an accessory to murder when I got to 10. But the first one was for... the mad Axeman, wasn't it? And then the second one was Ginger Marks, and then accessory after the fact was for Jack the Hat. So like they were the three murder trials. I mean, one's enough for any person, isn't it?
Well, unless you've been involved in one, you cannot believe how long, how intrusive, how thorough they are. They go on for like 2 years every day, all day, and talk to who you fell out with at school.
Oh.
And, you know, like, fucking hell. And if they get a smell of...
The bit of...
Anything.
Anyway, I got me little lucky old shoe there, look, and it's kept me lucky.
So, was there a real sense of loyalty with everyone?
Well, yes. I was fucking loyal to my people. I don't know, not so much the twins was bad news as far as I was concerned. I mean, they got me in all the fucking, that's where the trouble started then. And, they really did. When the guys, Ginger Marks, they went and shot my brother George, that was the start of my real problems, you know. And he knocked on his door, he opened the door and, just blasted him with a 12-bore shotgun, didn't I? Hit the wall at the end of the passage, and It's funny, the guy next door was a train robber who went and got to the Red Box and got the ambulance because he was there with his four daughters having their supper when the knock at the door. And of course, it was Ginger Marks who come and answered when he opened the door. He recognised him, George. It was Ginger Tom. So he went and sat down again. And he asked for a Moody address for someone. He said, no, I don't know anyone. He said, ask along. He said, I don't know anyone at that name. He asked for a Moody name. And, of course, he went and sat down to have a meal with his daughters and his wife and knocked on the door again. And he got up again. He went to the passage, opened the door, and the light had been removed outside on the balcony, so it was dark. But out stepped at the Evans. This Jimmy Evans stepped out of the shadows with a shotgun and hit him. Well, the front door, he hit the wall at the back of the passage. That's how it went. And of course,
in the bollocks.
Yeah, right down there. Absolutely, he was aiming for his privates. Yeah. But I had the pub at the time, and they come round. One of the daughters, Georgina, come round to me, and she said, "Well, my daddy's in hospital." Thomas, blah blah. I rushed go out to the hospital, and he's got all the old Bill all around, and I whistled. I said, "Where's it?" He said, "Ginger Tom." He said, "Ginger Tom." And that's all. I didn't know his other name. Didn't know it was but he knew it was Ginger Tom. That's all the name I had. And they was going to amputate his leg from the hip. But they never had an anaesthetist to carry out the operation, so that put it off to the following day. And otherwise, if there'd have been one on duty there and then on the night, they would have cut his leg off from the hip. Yeah, by the next day they managed to stop the bleeding. They got the bleeding stopped, and that saved his neck. And he was from then on, he recovered and he was all right.
It's a miracle.
What a lucky guy. Yeah, my George. But I mean, he was when I was a kid living in Croxteth House with my mother and father, and my four brothers were all fighting in the war all over the world. They were, and he was on a minesweeper called the Fitzroy, and there used to be Lord Haw was one of the broadcasting. He used to say, Germany calling. And he said, everyone used to listen to him. They hated him, but they listened to him, everybody. And when I used to tune in to see what he... English went quizzling, went over the German side.
His brother was dead and he came home.
He said, when the German Imperial Navy sank the minesweeper Fitzroy, all hands, it sank in 4 minutes, all hands were lost. And me and my father and mother, that's what we heard, Right. Now we're waiting for days, because in them blocks of flats, you see the telegraph boy coming on his bike, and everyone used to hold their breath, because they all had members of their family, husbands and sons and that, and our relations all in the forces at that time. And they always said, where's he going? He had the telegram, to say that one of the family had died. We was waiting for that to happen, and then I'm leaning over the balcony. My mother's doing the washing up the things in the kitchen, and all of a sudden a figure walks in and waves like that, waves a sailor hat in civilians, not uniform, but had a sailor's hat and went like that. I went, fuck, hell. I said to my mum, quick, mother, I said, come out, I said, it's our children. She come running out, drying her hands on her old hat penny, where Georgie? Oh, my Georgie.
He couldn't make it up. It's like
he couldn't, could he? And he come walking across the square. Of course, it was tears, all the neighbours were all down the pub that
fucking. He was upset because he had to share a bedroom again, and he didn't have his own bedroom.
So when did you meet the Krays?
When it was... with Charlie Kray, I knew Charlie Kray prior to it because he worked for a buyer who used to buy. He had plenty of money, this buyer in the East End. He used to come over and I had some lock-up garages up at Herne Hill. I'd half a dozen of them. Had all crooked motors in there and crooked gear, you know. And so, because the Bosch, he was famous, the Bosch, make a key to fit everything. Even the Bank of America, he made the keys for the Bank of America when they got it. Anyway, he could make a key for anything, right?
And the Bosch.
The Bosch, yeah. And he wasn't English, he was a foreigner. Anyway, the thing was, I had Buster and Tommy Wisby, the two train robbers, right? I got them. Dave was up and coming, like myself, you young guys at it. And I made a firm up with them. And we used to go round when it was half day closing day, all over London. And they'd have first, you'd have a Wednesday or Thursday shut down, and then they'd be opening on another matter, what I two in or Wandsworth or wherever it was. And of course, during that period, the High Street was shut. Everything was shut there. And
but there wasn't shots and red alarms or CCTV cameras or grills or chub lot, nothing.
Nothing like that. And, well, so we used to go and go in there and spin them and spin until you found the right one, right? Bang, and you spun it over. And I had a van with brown ovals and that, and go in there and pick up. That's when we was getting all the televisions and electrical goods from America. That was that period, you know, when nobody had a fucking Hoover cleaner even, did they, in those days?
Oh, everyone was mad from telling
you. Yeah, carpet sweeper.
And a dishwasher and a spin dryer. I'd never seen nothing like it, you know what I mean? Especially in Bermondsey with all the dockers, like they had the bit of cash. They was putting their orders in, no one's business, you know, because the old crane driver, they said, tipped it the side of the deck and all the goodies would go on the deck, wouldn't they? And they'd all have a pilfer. Everyone was at it, because they was all starving alive people, weren't they? They had to be crooked to survive. Anyway, so of course, when they're older, my daughter's getting married, can we get a nice... Watching Roberts, you remember them Roberts radios and
Roberts Rambler.
Rambler, lovely, where you got it?
That's a prison radio, Roberts Rambler.
Roberts Rambler.
Listen, can I just put in one minute? The best radio you could put, it doesn't matter if it's a multimillionaire. At one stage in prison, you weren't allowed to have a radio that had FM on it or something.
FM, yeah.
Because it fucked up with their walkie-talkies. It's a long time ago. Yeah. So the best radio you could get without FM was this thing called Robert's Rambler.
Rambler.
And every single prisoner that was worth a wank had one. And you used to have a little bit of round wood at the bottom that you could turn it.
Just
and a Robert's Rambler. And weren't the boxing good on that?
Oh, you got
listening to the boxing in a cell on a radio was fucking...
Oh,
better than being at the actual fucking fight, wasn't it?
Terrific it was,
and Sunday night, the top 100 on the radio.
Yeah. All the top 20, was the all the music. Bollocks, and that, yeah. Lovely sound on them as well, weren't they? Good quality.
Well, yeah, wood.
Lovely quality they were, yeah. Yeah, anyway, all that stuff was luxury stuff, but people wanted, but they couldn't afford it, the prices they were charging for from America. The time they shipped it over, it was right expensive. They topped the price right up, didn't they? And then the small televisions, the little 10-inch, then they went up the bigger, and then they got bigger, didn't they? 24-inch. So there was a constant market there for it to replace the old stuff.
Charlie Craig's mate used to come over and buy it all off of Fred.
Yeah, but so Charlie used to come and buy and take it all back. I used to empty me garages out, but he had the cash. Charlie, it wasn't Charlie's money, it was this guy, the buyer. It was his money. I can't remember his name. They kept him private from me.
Lovely man, though, Charlie.
Oh, he's a lovely Charlie. Guy, yeah. Oh, no, he was good.
Not a gangster,
good fella.
Not a, No, business matter, no, genuine.
And his wife Dolly was got friendly with my wife Maureen at the time, so they had a good relationship, and then they began seeing each other, and you know, having going out for meals together and things. Yeah. So that's how I got to know. And Charlie kept saying to me, "You got to come and meet the twins." I said, "Yeah, all right. I've heard all about the twins, you know, because they had a reputation already, what they was up to, but nothing special, like just fighting all the time, wasn't it? And beating up people, and they had the row with all them dockers, and that was the highlight of their career at the time, wasn't it?
Yeah.